Well, thank you very much, and it is a pleasure to and an honor to have been asked to give a talk tonight. This is kind of the public event for the conference, and for those of you all who haven't been at the conference all day long, we will do a little introduction of what we've been doing. For those of you who have been at the conference all day long, I bet you you wish that I would just say, why don't we meditate for the next 20 minutes? Because we have had a wonderful opportunity to hear from people all over the world about our concerns about weapons in space and nuclear power in space. And let's first give a great round of applause to all the organizers who have put this together. The board of the Global Network. How about everybody on the board of the Global Network stand up? Who's been working on this? And then how about all of our people from Huntsville who have really carried the load? Putting a conference together like this is always a great challenge, and the way the Global Network moves around the world, where every one of these 25 years of hosting conferences so that we, the world community, will find out more about what's happening in space, it's a real credit to you, a real credit. And most of our, how many of you all were not at the conference all during the day? Let's just see how many. So our public are part of the feminist chorus who just, they just disappeared. They said they needed to go out and practice one of their songs to make sure they could sing it for us. But yeah, so we want them to do that. But what I wanted to do to make sure they knew what this was all about is to have all of our international guests please stand up. Please stand up. From Japan, from India, from Nepal, from South Korea, from the United Kingdom, from Sweden. And then we have, I'm from Hawaii. That's. Did I leave any international folks out? Japan, India, Nepal, yeah. Korea, I said that. Sweden, UK. I think anybody else? Yeah, UK. So we've had a wonderful opportunity today to hear about things from other countries, what other countries are doing about these weapons in space. About space programs and how it affects us. And, you know, as a person who spent most of her life in the U.S. government, I left the U.S. government 14 years ago. So it's a small number of years that I've been with you all compared to the decades that you have been working for peace. So I really appreciate the opportunity now to be on kind of the right side of history. And it's groups like the Global Network that really, really are so important to us to understand what's going on in the world. And the presentations that we've heard today, you know, starting from, from Asia and the Pacific, where we have gone over the issues of a new weapon system that the United States is deploying in South Korea. The THAAD missile system, and one of those that which was already in another one of the islands of the Pacific, already in Guam, and where we have the X-band radar that is in Japan, that we have the issues of North and South Korea, that we have Jeju Island that has been a focus of so many. In fact, how many of you all have been to Jeju Island? Yeah, everybody that's been to Jeju Island, stand up. Jeju Island is a solid solidarity with those incredible activists who have, against all odds, kept pushing and pushing and pushing to try to stop that base. And now we need to continue the solidarity with the people on Jeju Island, but of course move on to make sure that we have international solidarity with you all that are so strong in challenging the THAAD missile in South Korea. And then we look to Japan, where we have had many in the international community that have gone to Okinawa, to Ora Bay, to Hinoko, to challenge the U.S. military building another runway out into the pristine Pacific Ocean. And how many of you all have been to Okinawa as a part of that? Stand up. And that battle is not over, for sure. They have now put back into place a lot of the dredging material, a lot of the dredging things that were actually gone when I was last there last summer. They had been taken away, and now apparently they have started moving them back, and potentially the dredging will begin any time now in Hinoko Bay. So that's another one of the places that we just cannot stop our international solidarity. And I wanted to give a real shout out to Veterans for Peace, because Veterans for Peace has had a delegation to Okinawa numerous times. And I think Will says he's ready to host another delegation to go in to South Korea and to Okinawa. So check with him and let's get another delegation going. It's so important that we, on an international scale, show solidarity. And as we look at things that are happening throughout the world, the things in North Korea, as is mentioned, I was very honored to be on this 30-woman delegation in 2015 that was a part of Women Cross the Militarized Zone. 30 women that went to Pyongyang and met with 250 women from North Korea on a two-day peace seminar. One day they told us about the Korean War. The Korean War from their perspective, where North Korea was demolished, devastated, purposely devastated by the United States government. It said there will be nothing standing when we get through with that. And that was true. And so you see a country that is trying to come back, and against all odds, with continuous international sanctions being put upon them. And one of the things I always kind of point out is, with all of the demonization of North Korea, and granted, I mean, there's plenty of things that the regime has done to its own people that none of us agree with. But when you look at the pressures, the international pressures that have been put upon it, it is remarkable to me that they do have a nuclear program. It is remarkable, and sadly, for the reasons that they have it for defensive purposes, because when the United States and South Korea and the kind of the Asian alliance has military exercises every 6 months on the DMZ, right next to North Korea. And as was mentioned earlier, one of the names of one of these exercises this last year was called Decapitation. Now, does that send a signal of what the U.S. mission is? Regime change in North Korea, and they know that. And so they have to defend against it. And the development of nuclear weapons and the testing of, what is it, six of them now? And then the development of this missile program that is causing the U.S. at least verbal fits. But as was pointed out, it's not an ICBM, it's not an intercontinental ballistic missile, and a missile testing is allowed by international law for them. Except, let's see, now international law doesn't apply if the United States doesn't like a country. Then our media doesn't even acknowledge that there is the legal right to have missile testing. And if you look at other places, as we've commented on today, the demonization of Russia. The demonization of Russia. I was in Russia a year and a half ago, and with a delegation of 15 people, and we went there specifically because at that time we were so concerned about all of the rhetoric that was coming out of the U.S. government under the Obama administration, and the media about, you know, the dangers of Russia. Regis came in, what was it, about 8 months later, 9 months later, and went on another tour that you can see the filming that he did in the movie, how many minutes till midnight, or how many seconds to midnight?
Yeah, but I also did one, Je Suis Russia, that's only 39 minutes. They really went into much more detail about Russian people and what they think. And
yes, so these are to now see after the election what has gone on now in our political realm of not just the demonization. I mean, I don't even hyper demonization of what about Russia. And then again, when you look at what the pressures of the international community is putting on Russia, where we have the United States and NATO with the largest military exercises since the Cold War that have been held right along the border with Russia, right in the Baltic states, in Poland. You know, for the first time in 25 years, the United States has moved more equipment into Europe. You know, since the fall of the Soviet Union in the early 90s, that was when the U.S. started drawing down its military bases, drawing out numbers of personnel, taking out equipment. But now we're starting to put him back in. And now an armored brigade, tanks, have now been put into Poland. A brigade that will be rotating its personnel into Poland and into the Baltic states. And the largest military exercises.
I'm sorry I interrupted. In Norway, in huge caves, 300 military tanks have been into the caves in the northern Norway.
In the northern part of Norway, 300 military tanks from the United States have been put into caverns that are in caves in Norway. So the buildup, the military buildup now that we're seeing, is very, very disturbing. And when, you know, all we hear about is, well, Russia is now having its largest military exercises it's had since the Cold War. Our media forgets to say it's in response to the U.S. and NATO exercises that have been held right along that border. And now let's see. The United States military always comes up with some dandy names for its exercises. So we have decapitation in Korea. Now what do we have for the name of the military exercise that's been along the border of Russia? How about the term anaconda? Uh-oh. The snake, the strangling snake that encircles and squeezes. That was the name of the last military exercise that we had in Poland. So is there a reason why the Russians are a little perturbed with the United States and NATO? Is there a reason why they may be having military exercises to confront what they are seeing? That they're seeing the mobilization, where in Romania there is the land-based Aegis missile. Now that missile, Aegis missile, it has a symbolism for me coming from Hawaii, because in the middle of the Pacific Ocean we have a military test center, a missile test center, and it's part of it is in Hawaii on the island of Kauai, where the Aegis missile has been tested numerous times, and it's tested in a strange way. Where are the rockets coming from that in Hawaii they send up a missile to try to hit?
Vandenberg,
California, Southern California. The United States is testing ICBMs. Is that what it is, ICBMs?
Yes, yes.
We send them off heading for Asia, and you think the Chinese might be wondering, is that Aegis missile out of Kauai going to come and get that rocket? Or at the official end of the Pacific test range is in another little small island group in the Marshall Islands, Kwajalein. Kwajalein, an island that the United States still pays modest rent. And the end of the missile test range is three quarters of the way out into the Pacific. So when the United States launches its ICBMs, I mean, China doesn't know what's going on. North Korea doesn't know what's going on. And I think they are probably hoping and praying that the United States Aegis missiles are going to come up and knock that missile out of the sky. Because if it doesn't, it's coming straight toward them. In Europe, where we've talked about the Russian challenges of their being very, very nervous about what the U.S. is doing. Very nervous about what we're doing. A lot of citizens in countries throughout Europe are very nervous about what the United States is doing. And in fact, this summer we're going to have various mobilizations. You know, we saw the mobilization in South Korea. We've seen mobilizations in Okinawa. In Europe, in this summer, there are going to be two major mobilizations. The first one is going to be in Brussels, Belgium, in May, and that's called No to NATO. NATO is going to be meeting in Brussels, and so there's going to be a large mobilization in Brussels, and then later on in, what is it, July, is the G20 protests that are going to be in Hamburg, Germany. And from what I'm hearing from colleagues in Europe, that G20 meeting is, the counter G20 meeting is going to be really, really big. People are coming in all over, from all over Europe, to say to the G20 countries that we don't like what you're doing. We don't like what you're doing economically, and we don't like what NATO is doing militarily. Now, we were talking on one of the panels this afternoon. I thought it was very, very interesting. When the questions came up, how do you keep mobilizations going? How do you get our neighbors to come out with us? How do we develop movements that can actually put pressure on our governments? And, you know, just a couple of thoughts on that. You know, in Seoul, Korea, where they've had millions of people out on the streets continuously, and where, I mean, have we tried in the United States to have a rolling series of major mobilizations? Well, actually, I think what's going on right now is the closest we've come, where we had the Women's March in January. We've had Standing Rock, the Indigenous March, of course, much, much smaller. We're going to be having the Climate March at the end of this month on April 29th, which is supposed to be a very, very big march. And I do appreciate what Regis said. In his talk, you know, that maybe mobilizations maybe we shouldn't be spending so much time on this. I think we should be spending time on it, but I also totally agree with him that we've got to spend even more time in our neighborhoods, that we've got to be talking to our friends and neighbors to say, look at these mobilizations that are going on, among other things, but look at what we can do locally, how pressure that we've got to put on our local city council for stopping police brutality, for no drones above our cities, for, you know, the endless things like challenging the federal government, taking money back for education and things like that. And we've also got to keep them attuned to a political process where, I personally do not want to get involved in politics, and I don't like going around talking about other people's candidacy, because we've been burned so many times on that. But if we are going to have any effect on what's happening in our country, I think we've got to hold our nose to some of this. And I know most of our organizations are 501c3, so you can't really do it through those organizations. But I think we as individuals have to figure out how we can get some people associated with us to go out and really do some hard lobbying in our own neighborhoods to get the right people elected to our school boards, our city councils, and then have some effect on the national scene, that we start getting some Congress people in there that we can rely on. It's important to do that, as well as these mobilizations. But the mobilizations, I think, are really important. And in the analysis of how we do these things, I think, well, geographically, we've got a real problem in that many of our mobilizations are in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. It is a small town. It's not like Seoul, Korea. It's not like Tokyo. It's not like New York City. It is a small town of, how many people live there? 600,000? 600,000. Many of them are government workers. Many of them are people of color. And if you look at our mobilizations, how many people of color do we usually have in our mobilizations? Not many at all. So the work that we need to be doing in our nation's capital to mobilize some of the people that are there, but I think we'll always have a difficult time in having continuous day in and day out mobilizations because that capital city is just not that big. Whereas in Seoul and in Tokyo, there's a much larger population base. It's not an excuse for us, but I think it's one of the things that we have to strategize of where we are going to put some energy and some time in on this. I want to mention one other thing about when we were talking about Russia. You know, the issue of space, Russia, space, weapons in space. If I got this right, our space program is pretty well dependent on Russia. That we still have, Russia is the country that has the capability, the rockets that move American and Russian and astronauts of all nationalities, they go all the way out to Kazakhstan, they get on top of a Russian rocket, and off they go. If we continue this, well, my understanding is that the American space program and the Russian space program and the people that operate those are desperately trying to keep all of this international politics out of the way of the space program, of the manned space program. That is probably the only cooperative effort that's going on right now with Russia. So here we are in Huntsville, Alabama, the home of the Marshall Space Center and the Redstone Arsenal. And I want to just welcome back our wonderful ladies of the feminist choir from Huntsville. And we want to say that as an organization of the global network against weapons in space and nuclear power, that it's not that we are going after the Marshall Space Center or anything like that. It's just that we want to make sure that the space programs that are internationally, that we all as citizens challenge our governments not to put weapons on any of the things that go into space.
Yeah.
That it will be a lethal decision by any government. And since the U.S. has this massive space program, we in the U.S. are desperately trying to make sure that our own country does not weaponize any of the rockets that go up in space. So we are here, right here in Huntsville, Alabama, with you all, and we've had a wonderful conference. And since these ladies are back here, I just want to have all of our international speakers to stand up so that they will know. From Japan, please stand up for these ladies. From India, from Nepal, from South Korea, from the UK, from the United Kingdom, from Sweden. So these are the women and men who represent organizations in their home countries that are trying to make sure that their countries also are very aware of the dangers of weapons in space and nuclear power in space. And I'd just like to just kind of close out, and Bruce, maybe, I don't know who's actually going to introduce our wonderful feminist choir, but just so that you all know, Bruce Gagnon is the coordinator of the Global Network. Bruce, will you stand up? We have lots of work to do internationally. We have lots of challenges as the world evolves under our new presidential administration here in the United States. And with all of the problems that we see in the Northeast Asian area, North Korea, South Korea, as we look to China, as we look to Russia, the challenges are immense. And it is citizen activism that is critical to making sure that our decision makers in our country know what we want, and that is no war, no war. So with that, I'll thank you all very much, and we look forward to some wonderful music from the Feminist Choir. Thank you.